right. That is our awesome Seaside band. Let's give them a hand. Good morning, Seaside. Morning. It's so nice to see you all this morning. Love spending my Sunday mornings with my Seaside family. I'm Gina Goodman. I'm a member here at Seaside. I am also one of the co-leaders of the young adults group here at Seaside, the Seaside Possibilitarians. Just got a couple announcements for you this morning. But first, I would love to begin by honoring the spiritual practitioner who will be holding the light for us this morning, Ms. Kathy Bacay. Great. Thank you, Kathy. Seaside Summer Celebration Potluck Picnic will be in the park over here on Sunday, August 16th at 12:30 p.m. So it's only 2 weeks away. Please plan to bring a dish to share. And of course, Seaside will provide burgers, turkey burgers, hot dogs, plus the music and the fun, of course. To find out more information on how you can help, please see the information for getting in touch with Melissa Spiegler, thank you, all right, in Inside Seaside. And we have a clip for your viewing pleasure.
Favorite things.
Hot dogs.
Hamburgers.
Teeth burgers.
Peanut butter and jelly sandwiches.
Hot dogs.
And there's actually going to be veggie burgers.
And, ooh, like a fruit salad.
Please come and join us, because it's going to be so fun.
I want everyone to come to Seaside Picnic because of the food.
We're coming to hang out with all the families.
Lots of fun.
You get wrap your mom and mom like a mummy.
Oh, wrap your mom and a mummy. Okay, I know that one. That's the toilet paper game, isn't it?
Yeah.
English chip butties, English sausage rolls.
And there's also going to be a water balloon fight.
Water balloon fight?
Kind of messy, but the egg, like the egg one, I don't know if you guys have ever played the egg one, you toss the egg tossing one. Don't be the one that the egg gets broken on. That's happened to me before.
We're going to have a good time.
Come to the Seaside Picnic because I'll be there.
Me too.
See you at the Seaside Picnic.
Great food, lots of fun, laughter, and having a good time with the people we love.
Doesn't that look like so much fun? Woo. I went last year. It's just a blast, and I would love to see you all there. I'd love to hang out and get to know you, so come on down. Our wonderful, amazing spiritual leader here at Seaside, Dr. Christian Sorensen, will be signing his new book at the Seaside Bookstore next Sunday after second service. You can now order the book from Seaside's website, so be sure to check that out and have it ready for next Sunday and have it signed by Dr. Christian. There are always many educational opportunities here at Seaside, so please read about the current workshops and classes in Inside Seaside this morning. The Congregant Care Ministry has what's called Seaside Thursdays. These are evening events. They start at 6:30 with a half an hour social, and the event begins at 7 p.m. Basically, there's different speakers who talk about different topics regarding overall well-being, and these are simply love offering basis. The deep sound meditations are still going on through the end of the summer. They're here in the sanctuary on Monday evenings, and they start at 6:30 p.m. Seaside offers bereavement support groups on Tuesdays from 12:30 p.m. to 2:30 in the afternoon. They're led by Ms. Jan Hartman, and Jan is actually a certified bereavement specialist. So that's Tuesdays from 12:30 p.m. to 2 p.m. Our lovely Seaside sisters will be presenting what's called Summer Eve. This is a oneness blessing and garden meditation. It'll be on Friday, August 7th at 7 p.m. Enjoy a beautiful summer evening in Seaside's gardens with your fellow amazing Seaside sisters. There's a table in the back in the family room. There's flyers for you to actually take home, and be sure to be here for this amazing event. Today at 1 p.m. will be a hilarious improv event that's called Outside the Lines. It's a variety of comic sketches, and it's actually created on the spot from audience suggestions. So if you've never seen an improv event, it's absolutely hilarious. Be sure to check that out today at 1 o'clock, and we have another clip for your viewing pleasure.
Has never been seen before, and it will never be seen again because we are going to Vegas.
You know, I'm tired of bridges that go across things. This time I want a bridge that goes straight up.
how many licks does it take to get to the second floor?
Dragons competing on Top Chef.
Dragons competing.
Awesome, looks like so much fun. So it is today at 1 o'clock, and Cafe on Lake will be open for lunch after second service. They will be serving an entirely gluten-free menu. It'll be Korean barbecue chicken, organic steamed brown rice, salad with ginger dressing, and the best part, homemade vegan banana coconut ice cream. Yes, sounds pretty good. And finally, as it is the first Sunday of the month, we will be having our basic beliefs class after second service at 12:30 in the Emerson Room. It's an opportunity for you to attend a free class, ask any questions you have, ask how we live our lives in this beautiful, wonderful philosophy that changes lives that's called the Science of Mind. So please be sure to check out that free class at 12:30 after second service. And now I would love to invite you all to stand and say good morning and greet your neighbors. Seaside, please remain standing for the congregational song. Everybody.
Good morning, Seaside! How's your summer going? That is good. Sun is out or not, it doesn't matter. It is here in this town. It's wonderful to share this summer months with you, going through Brené Brown's work on the gifts of imperfection, because I got to tell you, I've got a lot more imperfections than I was thinking I had as I take a look at this. But there's gifts there, so I'm doing the work. Flowers are gorgeous today. The Seaside Sisters got together last evening and pulled together over 200 people for a fabulous film called Love Thy Nature, and just the beautiful expression. Thank you, Callie, and the magical night that was here. Speaking of magic going on at Seaside, you know, we had a lunch last week, a brunch, a concert, fed over 220 of us stuck around for lunch. And so I just want to say thank you to the Board of Trustees that threw the party for all of us and the fun that we had. And it was just truly a great, great day. So they were fabulous. There's a lot of good going on at Seaside, and it's because we always put spirit first, and that's what we're going to do right now by calling in that deep recognition of the divine. And a wonderful person to lead us to that place is a practitioner by the name of Bob Greer.
In your chair, and as we move into the stillness. So I know and affirm that there is one power, one presence that is right here, right now, that is in and through all things, that there is nowhere where this power is not, this loving presence, this loving intelligence that is in and through everything. And I know I am one with this power. I am created of the same as everything else in the universe. And as I know this for myself, I know this for each and every person that is here. So grateful for this opportunity to be able to spend this time together, knowing that everything that is said today is divinely guided and divinely blessed. I bless this service and I bless this day, and I simply say, and so it is.
God is so good. God is so good. God is so good. He's so good to me. God is so good. God is so good. God is so good. He's so good to
beautiful. God is so good to me and to each and every person here. Thank you to our wonderful pianist and for Rebecca Jade for this call to worship. So good morning, Seaside. My name is Reverend Lori McMackin, and we welcome you here today, knowing that we come together as one on a Sunday to celebrate this joyful expression that we call life, knowing that we are always grounded in spirit, and we live by those eternal qualities of God, of love and joy and peace and wholeness and wealth and health and beauty and grace, and they're eternal, and they go on and on and on, and this is the time that we commune with like-minded people and remind ourselves of this. So if you are brand new
If you are a guest today, welcome home. And there is a welcome packet for you by the door. And I invite you to look in that packet. There are many coupons for you to find your way around Seaside. And don't forget to look at the Inside Seaside in your program and make sure you come to one of our events. Sign up for a class. Come to the picnic next week and knowing that we are like-minded people and we are here for you and we are here to give love and share love and be in community. So next Wednesday, or this coming Wednesday, I want to invite you to the Wednesday night service with Reverend Debbie McDonald. She will be speaking about the power of vulnerability. And then on August 12th, myself, Reverend Lori Mack, will be speaking about the science of getting rich, based on the book, The Science of Getting Rich by Wallace Wattles, that was written in 1901. And there is a scientific process, and anyone can become rich. So we are going to go through that process. And on August 23rd, woohoo! Big day here at Seaside, the last two Sundays of the month. Christian is going to be going on vacation. So when the cat's away, the mice will play. And this will be my opportunity to be on pulpit. I'm very excited. Yes, and when I was meditating, it's like on the breath, it came through. It's divine discontent. So I'll be talking about that divine urge within you that's always seeking to expand and seeking to grow. And I wanted to let you know that I saw this amazing keynote speaker, and she had 3 million hits on her TED Talk, and she helps you discover how to get what you want. It's very simple, so I'm going to bring that tool here to Seaside. It's going to be very exciting. So I will see you then. Also, we have our congregant here. His name is Steve Dahl. Him and his wife have been taking classes here at Seaside. They've been transforming their lives, and he's a very creative person, and he's going to come up here and share his journey and share his creative poetry with you. Steve, let's give him a big hand.
Well, good morning, Seaside. Christian is going to be speaking today again about Brené Brown's research and work on shame. Shame can be a powerful thing. It can be a devastating thing. I had the pleasure of taking a course about a year and a half ago with Reverend Lori Sheets on shame and Brené Brown's work. And it gave me a lot of inspiration, gave me a lot of ideas. And I have that shame part of me that I need to deal with. We all do. And it helped me to bring forth some of my creativity. So I put some of my experience into a poem. Let me share it with you. This is called My Shameful Story. The shame I've buried deep inside festers there. It's still alive. It is not buried deep enough to hide me from my ugly stuff. I know it's in there playing dead, imperfection in my head. It keeps me small, controls my heart. This shame could tear my life apart. I can't control my shameful story, all its pain and all its glory. I cannot lose this shameful cloud until I speak my truth aloud. One cannot beat my shame to death. It never takes a final breath. To beat my shame, it must be heard and banished with my spoken word. And so it is.
Thank you. That's a beautiful story of transformation, a real-life transformation by Steve Dahl. And his story is everyone's story. So Reverend Christian has a message for each and every one of us today, talking about intuition, trusting faith, and creativity. And I would like to set the tone for that, for I know Spirit has brought you here today to hear something, to hear a message for you to take home with you and to live in that message. I invite you to close your eyes and just to go within with me as we open our hearts. We open our minds to the presence of Spirit, recognizing that there is only one unlimited substance from which all things are created. It is the essence of love and joy and wholeness. It is that living intelligence that's always seeking to create out of itself, everywhere in its fullest. And knowing that my life is the life of God, for I am that expression of wholeness. I am that creativity. I am divine intuition. I am wisdom and I am faith. And as I know that moves through my body, I know this moves through each and every person here in this congregation. creation, for I know each person is that divine, individualized creation of God. You were sent here today for a message that's going to be called to you through the message of Dr. Reverend Christian Sorensen. As he allows that expression of the Spirit to speak through him, as he allows it to speak through him, it speaks to you, into your heart, into your soul, into your mind. It becomes the essence of who you are. As you take this message home with you, you evolve and you grow and you expand in consciousness. You expand in your awareness of God as your life, and I am grateful for this now. I'm grateful that you are here today to commune with like-minded people, to be lifted up to the essence of love and joy, to be lifted up to the expression of Spirit, Spirit as God as your life now. So I'm grateful for this community. I'm grateful that we come together as one to commune with the power and the presence of God as your life. As I release my word into the law of mind, knowing that it is done with great, deep, abiding faith, and so it is.
Oh, that'll get you going. What's up, Seaside? Good morning. Well, it's my honor to introduce our guest artist for today, and she's been with us many times, and we just love her when she's here. She's got beautiful messages within her songs, and if you're moved by her music, please see her after the service today at the table, and without further ado, help me welcome Miss Peggy Lebo.
Good morning. So I'm one of those scary recovering pastor's kids. You've heard all those stories about, they're all true. I remember I moved to California and vowed never to go to church again until someone brought me to Seaside and taught me that all roads to God are valid and that everything is holy.
As a girl each week, Sunday we would go to church, pay attention to the priest, he would read the holy word, consecrate the holy bread, and everyone would kneel and bow. Today the only difference is, everything is holy now, everything, everything. Everything is holy now. When I was at Sunday school, we would learn about the time Moses split the sea in two, and Jesus made the water wide. I remember feeling sad that miracles don't happen still. Now I can't keep track, 'cause everything's a miracle. Everything, everything, everything's a miracle. Everything, everything, everything's a miracle. Why? Finding where there isn't one. Very hard to say. See
tell you that it can't be done. This morning outside I stood, I saw a little red-winged bird shining like a burning bush, singing like a scripture verse. Cause everything is holy now. Everything, everything, everything is holy now. Everything, everything, everything is holy now. It's holy now. Holy now. Everything's a miracle. Everything is holy now. Everything's a miracle. Everything is holy now.
Everything is a miracle now. Now is the appointed hour for sure. Ooh, I just love that song. That's fabulous. Thank you. Thank you. Oh, wow. So here we are at Seaside in the midst of a journey through taking a look at our imperfections. How fun is that? Brene Brown. yeah, right. Okay. So Brene Brown wrote this book, The Gifts of Imperfection, so hopefully I trust we're finding some gifts as we do take a look. And she's a researcher, as you heard, Steve. Fabulous poem, Steve. Thank you very much. That was fabulous. She sat down, did interviews with thousands of people in regards to their shame, their vulnerability, and their fear. And she came up with the approach to how to move through that and live wholeheartedly. It's about living wholehearted life is what her book has really been focused on. And she gave us some guideposts to that. And the first four that we looked at is being authentic, your authentic self. And the second one is a self-compassion. Then the third one had to be your resilient spirit that comes forth. And last week, we took a look at two, which happened to be joy and gratitude. And today, the fifth guidepost happens to be about intuition and faith. It's cultivating the intuition and trusting your faith. And if we have time, we'll touch the sixth one that has to do with creativity. But the thing about intuition is that it's something that we can cultivate. It is something that we can begin to develop, but we have to know and trust that it is inside of us that is seeking to express itself. And the thing with intuition, it's as if we got dropped in this cosmic stream, that we got dropped in the soul and the spirit of God. Our soul got dropped in the stream of God, and we got to see it all. It's like all of a sudden, boom, there's the full picture. Intuition is seeing that full picture. It's having a perception of the fullness without really a reasonable or rational way in which we got there. It's boom, the lights go on, you see it, and boom, off it goes. Can you remember that? Ernest Holmes talks about God seeing deductively, sees that whole picture. And we as humans tend to see inductively, which is from the part to the whole. We see a piece, and we put together with another piece, and we put together with another piece. And next thing you know, the whole picture emerges. But the intuition says, you know what? I can see. I can see it all. I get where it's going. And I'm going to have this faith, and I'm going to jump in, and I'm going with it. And oftentimes, intuition, for me, I think it comes like this whisper. You know, this inkling, this insight, maybe. But what I've come to discover, not only quiet, but it comes out boldly and says, Christian, check this out more. You know, it's not just quiet. It says, Christian, you need a little more research here. Put the pen to the paper, the pencil to the paper. Do the math. Research it more. Your intuition can shout at you and says, you know what? I don't see the whole picture yet. You need some more information here, Christian. Don't just trust the not knowing. Trust that something inside of you that says, look more. See, the gifts of imperfection is sometimes when you jump in and you don't see it all. It's like, oh, gosh. But next time, what I'm going to do is look at it a little bit more. And so cultivating the intuition allows one to be able to recognize that it speaks quietly and it speaks boldly. And there's different ways in which you get to hear and to feel that spirit. And the more you trust your intuition, the more you cultivate it, the more it becomes real, the more it pans out, the more you become familiar with the way it sounds, the more it becomes a real experience for you. Then the other aspect of this chapter is faith. And for Brené Brown, she's a very logic, reasoning person. And in a chapter that she found out had to be on intuition and faith, she said, oh, no, they're challenging my reasoning mind again. You know, it can be tough. But the thing with faith is that you've got to be willing to let go, which is a tough thing for people to do when we like certainty. You know, I'm willing to be vulnerable just so long as I'm certain it's going to be okay. So anyway, I wanted to read to you her part about faith here. And I have faith my eyesight will be fine. So letting go of the need for certainty is an important aspect of faith. And she wrote that faith is a place of mystery, where we find the courage to believe in what we cannot see and the strength to let go of our fear of uncertainty. We love closure, resolution, and clarity while thinking that we are these people of faith. How strange that the very word faith has come to mean its very opposite. Faith is essential when we decide to live and love with our whole hearts in a world where most of us want assurance before risk being vulnerable and getting hurt. To say, I'm going to engage wholeheartedness in life requires believing without seeing. That's faith. Believing without seeing. A willingness to go forward. A willingness to know. You know why children see magic? It's because they look for it. They believe in it. And as we grow and we mature, what do we look for? It's called worry and anxiety. You know, instead of looking for magic and having faith in the wonder of spirit showing up, we've got this worry and anxiety. And what that is expecting the worst to show up. Where trust is expecting the best to show up in our life. You know, birds, when they're sitting on a branch, they don't worry that the branch is going to break because they don't put their trust in the branch. They put their trust in their wings. And what happens is we tend to want to put our trust in what we can see. Well, that's not faith. Faith is being able to trust that which you can't see, being able to trust that there's something more here beyond my logical reasoning kind of mind because I have seen it. I caught an intuitive perception of the full picture that says, it's going to work out, Christian. But you got to be willing to risk, to be vulnerable, and to have the faith that even this difficulty, this too shall pass in my life, that there's something that is going to unfold that is greater here in my life. And this difficulty, this challenge that really irks me, is that a strange word? I read it this week. I knew I'd use it in a sentence. Irk. That which irks me, I got to realize I gave an invitation to show up in my life so it can show me how to know peace where it's been absent in my world. I'm going to know peace here instead of absence. And the hard lesson, I'm not going to let harden my heart. How often have you allowed a hard lesson to harden you, to close you down? That's not faith. That's not being vulnerable. That is closing down. It is believing in the myopic perception that this is no good, as opposed to realize that this imperfection is going to lead to something greater, and I'm going to have faith in that, which will allow me to be wholehearted in my living approach to life. I am going to go for that, and when the challenge shows up in my life, I'm going to think less about what I don't want to experience and begin to think more about where it is I want to go in life. Yeah. Think less about what you don't want to experience and think more about where it is you're going. That's good. I like that one. You know, it's really how we twist things. But that's part of the larger picture. It's how am I going to see it? You know, there's an old story of a king who had a dream that scared him. So he called in his two best advisors, told him the dream that he dreamt that he lost all of his teeth. And his first advisor said, King, I'm just so sorry to tell you, that's bad news. You know, as I interpret that, what that means is that all your relatives are going to die. That means your brother, your sister, your father, your mother, and you're going to live out the rest of your life alone. And the king said, I don't like that interpretation. Would you take this guy and give him 100 lashes? And, you know, the other interpreter of the dreams knew that he was right. But he said, King, you know what? I got good news for you. It means you're going to live a long life, and you will outlive all your relatives. Yeah. How are we twisting that? Are we going to live with the worry and the anxiety because we are expecting the other shoe to drop? Perception is it? Or are we going to be like those children that are looking for the magic? They say, I caught a glimpse of the fuller picture. And you know, there is good in store. There is 100% chance of the divine showing up in my life. And I'm going to believe this. I'm going to have faith. I'm going to trust my faith. I'm going to give up my need for certainty on basing stuff on the outside and begin to believe what's on the inside of my soul and my spirit. I'm going to be creative, which is another guidepost of Brené Brown. Creativity. You know, and creativity is originality. It is being that conduit. It is allowing spirit to flow, to express itself in ways in which it hasn't. And we have sold out on our creativity because we want to fit in. It's like I want to get into comparison and competition, but I'm going to be creative in my comparison and competition. I'm going to fit in so I can stand out. You know, I'm going to make it. So with you guys, so I can be better than you guys. You know, you're still fitting in. That's not creativity. That is fitting in so you can do it better than anybody else. What you want to do for creativity is to be that vortex of its expression to bring the uniqueness to humanity, to your world, to bring a new idea and a new thought to where there is fear and confusion because there is the tribe or the herd that will think in a certain way. And you can say, hey, you can look at it like this. So I love our music. It is just a divine expression of creativity made manifest for all of us to feel the stirring in our soul, in our spirit. We want to be creative in life because that is the way in which spirit can show up in a new way. And that takes faith. You know how much guts it takes to stand up here and sing a new song for the first time without a clue whether you're going to like it or not? You don't know how it's going to fall? Try talking every Sunday with some new stuff, too. That's a stretch. Yeah. It's... So what I realize about creativity is a lot of times people say, and me included, is I'm just not a creative kind of person. That's kind of our excuse. I'm just not creative. But there is no such thing as non-creative people. You got people who express their creativity and people who don't express their creativity. And if you don't express your creativity, it's not as if it's gone. It is just, it's lurking in there in the recesses of your subjective mind, just waiting to be called on. And it's up to us to find our medium of creativity. But what happens with creativity, I found for so many people, is they're just too exhausted to be creative. They're just tired. You know, I get up early. If I'm up early, I write. That's my creativity. But, you know, other than that, you know, I get Trevor ready for school. I go to work. If I don't teach class, I'm home in time for dinner, spend some time with my family. It's night. I'm tired. I go to sleep. And I wake up and I do it again. And I love what I do and I work on the weekends. But you know what? There isn't necessarily a lot of time for me to paint and carve wood and sing songs. I remember what Jean Houston once shared with me. And when she was working with Hillary Clinton, when they were in the White House, she'd go spend the weekend with them or a few days with them once a month. And she worked with Hillary, getting in touch with the consciousness of Eleanor Roosevelt until Hillary got in trouble for doing such stuff. And then that relationship stopped. But what she said is, and she was talking about spirituality, and was saying it's not as if Bill Clinton, president at the time, is not a spiritual person or opposed to spirituality or meditation. It's just his day is so full and so busy, there just isn't time for that in terms of his priorities in doing things. And so I say that in terms of creativity and saying we're too busy. We need to make that a priority so we can be that vortex for that expression to come out and take what is important in our life and put it out there, because you are creative and we have different expressions of creativity. I mean, Callie, she is just brilliant in her creativity. If you came to that film on Friday night, it was just magnificent. It was beautiful. And, you know, if I were to throw a film screening, what I would do is I would unlock the door and flip the switch, and we would watch a film. And you know, guys would go, that's good. Well, Callie starts weeks in advance sketching out what the place is going to look like, where the tables are going, the tablecloths, and ironing the overlays, and planting the flowers, and the fountains, and the booths, and the music, and the ambiance. And you come in, and it is a magical experience because of the creative energy that she puts in to create such a thing. It was good. Yeah. What I am tempting to say is you can bring creativity to anything, where I don't see this as a spot to fluff. Callie just sees it as an opportunity to deliver spirit in such a pleasing kind of way. You know, how do you do that? You heard a while back at the beginning of summer, we got rid of like a couple hundred feet of grass in our yard to save water, and I threw down those flagstones. I make it sound so simple now, don't I? And I'm done. But here's Callie. She goes back and she takes these jelly bean little pebbles and puts them through all the cracks and spends another week doing mosaics and white rocks and another week green rocks and putting color down and polishing these stones. And it's like, where did you come up with that kind of stuff? But that spot is available to all of us to come up with that new kind of stuff. And it is not about comparison. It is about what feels good to the soul and the spirit. How can I be more creative in my life so I become a vortex through which that life energy flows into expression? Spirit is seeking to express itself in our life. Are you giving it access? You know, it takes faith. Let me tell you, it takes faith to put something out there that hasn't been put out before. But if you're willing to be intuitive, you catch a glimpse as to how that whole picture is to look, how it's going to be. But what's important here is that you make it a priority, that I'm going to put my meditation or my spirituality on the top of my priority list. I'm going to create space in my day so I can be a creative expression, because part of wholehearted living is not just doing the routine day after day after day. Wholehearted living is bringing forth that which turns your soul and your spirit on, that allows you to go forth in life in a new kind of way. It allows you to get in touch with that wilder part of your being. Because what happens is we have become domesticated. We have been tamed into the ways of the tribe. We are bound by the intellectual and physical boundaries of our clan or culture, if you would. We have been schooled in the cautious kind of living so we can have a sense of certainty and comfort. But what I believe is there is something in our soul and our spirit that craves for the freedom, the cry of the wild, if you would. You know, I hunger to go home to the wilderness, literally. After watching that movie on Friday night, I'm just reminded of nature. It's just standing in there. It just restores my soul. It replenishes my spirit to walk on the rugged coastline that is jungled in Costa Rica, or to stand in the towering pines along the lakes and the mountaintops in Montana. I breathe in that air, and all of a sudden there's an aliveness that is just activated in the very cells of my being. There is something in us all that wants to return to the wildness of who we are and the wilderness of our being. And nature helps us to remember that, you know what, we are more than the routine of what we're doing in our life. And creativity encourages us to come out, to be more that, to listen to that the wildness, the Pharaoh in our pheromones, in our intuition that wants to be set free again. And freedom's not polite, let me tell you. You know, it doesn't come knocking on the door, Christian, can you come out to play now? Freedom slaps its down on the table and says, let's dance. Let's go. Yeah. And it's that letting yourself out there. You know, that freedom is standing out and looking at the rugged, glacier-cut mountaintops and feeling the chill on your face and the wind in your hair and drinking from that mountain stream. It's being walking on the beach and feeling the sand on your toes and getting dirt under your nails and the sun on your naked body. It is allowing the wildness of your nature so you can return back into the domesticated realm in which we are operating with a fire, with a passion, with a willingness to be creative in expressing what we've come here to express without fear, without a self-consciousness of saying, oh my goodness, what are people going to think about this self-expression? You know what? This is what I'm doing. You either like it or you don't, but this is who I am as I walk this world with a deep faith and a deep passion, because I have put my wild essence, my true self, my creative self first, and have given it space in my life, and I've recharged it. I found what I can do to feel it. I mean, we're blessed here. We got nature. Oh, my goodness. You know, in Southern California, it doesn't get any better than the North County of San Diego, you know? Yeah. We got plenty of beach and ocean breeze. I got a backyard. I can stick my hands in the ground and earth myself all I want, you know, and cut out grass and plant trees. But you know what? You've got to put what is most important to you first. You got that? Yeah. And how come we don't get that goal? It's because we put what's second first. So we don't get really what's most dear to our heart and soul. And when you put what's second first, you find yourself in trouble. You find yourself depleted. You find yourself imprisoned. You find yourself dying. Recently read an article of a couple hundred whales that marooned themselves in a bay and died because they were chasing a school of sardines. These huge giants of the ocean died because they were following a fish this size. They forgot the truth of their being, and they were led to death by something so small. Don't forget what you've been charged to do. There's a story they tell in the business realm of a lighthouse. And the lighthouse is on a rocky shoreline, and its, you know, mission is shine the light so the boats don't crash on the rocks. And they're close to town, and there's this tells the story of this one time. Someone came to the lighthouse that gets its ration of oils at the beginning of every month, supposed to last a month, and somebody from the town came and said, "Hey, get a little bit of oil. I need to really lubricate the wheels of whatever it was." No problem. You know, and then a mom came and said, "Can I have a little bit of oil? You know, my family, I need to cook for them, you know, so they don't starve. A little bit of oil is okay." And then a man came at night and said, "It's really cold. I need a little bit of oil to keep my house warm so my children don't freeze to death." By all means. And towards the end of the month, the oil got low until it ran out. And that night, there was no beacon, and a ship crashed on the rocks, and lives were lost. And when they investigated, and he shared the story, and they said to him, "Only thing we told you to do is to use the oil for the light. That's what you were charged with." And sometimes we get these little minnows, sardines, little things that sound just right, pulling at us, saying this, and we take our attention over here because it seems logical. You know, it's like, but you know what? It's because I've taken my eyes off of that larger picture, that I intuitively got that is beyond reason, but I saw it, I knew it, my soul knows it. I've got faith, I'm following this, you know, and I'm being creative and bringing it about. I'm going, and all of a sudden I'm called over here to look at this, which really doesn't honor that fuller picture, but it kind of made sense. But we allowed ourselves to be distracted by the sardines and the small things. There was a family that lived in the city, and they had just got tired of the traffic, the energy, the heat, the noise, the cars, the asphalt, all that thing. They decided they were going to move to the country, buy a ranch, raise cattle, live happily ever after, and they did that. They sold their house, they moved there. And they were living there for a little while, and some friends, their neighbors, came to visit them out in the country. And they asked, so what's the name of your ranch? And they said, "Well, you know, we kind of debated over that. We had a little struggle. You know, I wanted to call it the Flying W. And my wife, she wanted to call it the Suzy Q. And my son wanted to call it Bar J. And my other son wanted to call it the Lazy Y. So what'd you guys call it?" And he said, "Well, we called it the Flying W, Suzy Q, Bar J, Lazy Y Ranch." He said, "Well, I haven't seen any cattle out here." And he said, "Well, we don't have any. None of them survived the branding process." You know. Yeah. We just get so blown out of proportion with our stories, and I want us to get that you've been charged, your soul and your spirit, with that picture, with that image, with that vision in which you have been given to see, and that you have the creative faculties to bring forth that which enriches your soul and your spirit, that lets your wild nature out, but you can't allow yourself to be sidetracked by the errors that call your attention in this world. And when I talk about errors, I'm talking about those things in our human experience that grab us. You know, and we have them. I'd like to say we're not going to have any errors or challenges in our life, but we do almost daily. You know, all of a sudden, you know, we've got this situation that pulls our awareness off that God presence, that number one thing I need to be looking at, and I begin to look at the challenge at here. And Ernest Holmes tells us they will come in condition, they will come and they will look like a person, a place, a thing, or a condition. But don't be fooled by them. They are all errors of erroneous thinking, that your problems are neither person, place, nor thing, but rather is the thinking behind that them that empowers it. But all of a sudden, the condition shows up, and it looks like a doctor's report. You know, the errors don't show up and say, hey, Christian, I'm an error. I'm going to really mess up your life. You know, it will say, you know what? No, forget that. I'm doing my spiritual stuff. No, it shows up like a doctor's report or a financial statement or something in a relationship. And all of a sudden, the mind starts moving to the adulteress or that bank statement or whatever the challenge is and starts putting, I need to heal this situation. And I start, as I begin to fight it and pray against it, I enliven it, I imbibe it, I bring essence and passion with it. I use my creativity in a way that puts the very power in the thing I don't want to look at. And as I was saying, you know, think less about what you don't want to experience and look more at what it is you do want to experience. But we're looking at that. I don't want to experience this because of this and that. Error. It's an error. It's like looking at the railroad tracks coming together. We all know that's a mirage. It's a hypnotic trance. We know it doesn't come together, but it looks like it. Well, in our life, these errors that are human conditions that continuously will show up in our life will look real and grab our attention. I want to pray against it. And in that, I'm giving it power in life. What I need to do is move my awareness to God and be God only. You know, when I pray with folks, I usually throw the error into the beginning of the prayer just because they want to hear that I heard what they're saying. And, you know, it's like, and it's kind of valuable for them to hear that. But I'll tell you what, I get to the place where it's absolute spirit. And I stay there. If I pray for myself in the middle of the night and something's got me and it's boing, the eyes, I just, for a half hour, I'll talk about God to myself. I will talk about this life force, this life presence, this all animating something, this omnipresent, omnipotent, light, power, joy, this abundant flow, this perfect health, this divine right action, this essence, this first breath, this first cause, that from which I was created, that there could be nothing else. And I, for an hour, I will think of nothing but God. And in this place, this God field and this God realization, and that other stuff just can't exist. And I'm not battling that. And it comes down to, how are you using your creativity? Do you have enough faith to stop battling those errors or those misperceptions that you have used your creativity to create, to invite into your world? Are you willing to use this creative energy with a deep faith because you have caught this intuitive perception of the whole picture that already exists and it all leads to your greater good? And it is in this moment that I'm going to declare, decree, proclaim, and pronounce the allness of God is my very experience with all my faith and with all my creativity, because there's something intuitively in me that knows that that is the truth. Yes. How about you? Yes. Love you. Hey, let's keep it going as we bring Peggy to the Paul Lloyd Warner piano.
That was great. I needed to hear that.
All right.
Thank you. So I have a new song I just finished 2 days ago. And a friend of mine's daughter is turning 13. And she's this amazing, creative, beautiful person. And they asked me to sing at this event. And so I wrote this song telling her the things I wish someone had told me when I was turning 13. So.
Sometimes your heart is opened by the beauty of the day, and the light shines all around you as you make your way. Every step a little closer to all you're meant to be. Then sometimes you stumble as you're trying to break free.
That's Peggy Lebo. What a birthday gift for that 13-year-old. My, oh my, how lucky is she? Okay, well, this is the time of our service where we have the opportunity to unite together in the givingness and the sharing of our offering and sharing of our love. And just know that your gift does make a difference in Seaside's ability to continue what it is we do, which is to bring Spirit forth, to create a space for our children to come and grow and discover their self-worth, for us to be able to take the classes, to have a tribe that reminds us of our true wholeness and well-being. So with that, I want to invite our ushers to come forward and say thank you to this wonderful crew, and thank you to those who mail in your contributions when you can't be here on a Sunday. It's greatly appreciated. And those who remember us with the auto tithe, that regular systematic support from your world into Seasides. It helps us to have that kind of consistency to be able to continue on a regular basis of what it is we do. And I share this prayer of gratitude with the most generous of spiritual communities, knowing that this truly is a blessed moment where the divine unfolds its expression through each and every one of us, for we have become that vortex of that divine emanation, and that we take that which has blessed and graced our world and send that kind of energy forth into the world, knowing it brings more love to those it comes in contact. It feels so right to be used by the presence of God, that life force that brings just a richness and a sense of joyous abundance into our experience. And so continuously being that transparency for the abundance of the universe to flow into form, we send this with love in our hearts and know how blessed we are, and so it is. Amen. Together, let us say this affirmation of abundance, which is, Spirit continues to bless my world. Gratefully, I live as the giving expression of Spirit, opening the floodgates of the affluent flow of greater good as my life now. Guys from Seaside. Nice job. And so as I stand before this bounty, I can feel the love that is just pouring forth through each and every one of us. For we truly have become that divine channel, that conduit of God's loving expression. And I know right now that is made manifest in this abundant expression of collective good. For that wellspring of God has moved through our soul and our spirit, bringing with it the richness of joyous living. And so this gift that has been made in love, it is taken in care and in love and handled in good stewardship, and it's put forth back into that stream, bringing this energy of blessings to all that comes in contact. Thank you, Father, Mother, God, for this moment to pause and to be that wonderful expression of life. And so it is. Amen. All right.
Thank you.
This is Rick Merica. He is your board president. Oh my goodness, Peggy, it is just wonderful to have you home. You're a blessing to us all, a sister of Seaside and mine, and just decades of love. So appreciate you. And Rebecca Jade, you are just a bright, vibrant expression of life. And if you have read Inside Seaside, you can see Jade's bio in there. So now you are known. We know you, no longer hiding. And we just know how blessed we are to have you leading us in song and music and artistry. So thank you. Reverend Lori Mack, fabulous and terrific as always. If you want more Lori Wednesday nights, or as she was telling you, August 23rd, right here. Hey, giving us sound today is Ed, giving us the visual is Marv. Great job, guys. Know that there's CDs available right after the service. And there's Timothy behind that camera, live streaming this to the world. Tim, we appreciate you. And those at home, we appreciate you, your love, your support. We know you are there. Keep writing to us. It feels good to be in contact. So thank you. We love you and appreciate you for sure. Hey, there's a lot going on at Seaside, so take a look at your program. Like, right as soon as I'm done talking, we have lunch waiting for us at a cafe on Lake. We heard what it is, so it should be fabulous. And afterwards, the improv class and workshop or show is going on here. And I was looking for it, but you saw the clip on it. It's fun. It's funny. It's like the TV show that's out there, and it's live at Seaside. So take advantage of that. Also, Friday night, just a very special experience for the women here at Seaside. The Seaside Sisters and Callie have created for a second year in a row just a special evening of the Oneness Blessing, and it's for women only, and it's just last year, you can see there are 100 women out there at Diksha, and it's just a special, quiet, peaceful moment in the garden of meditation and chanting, and it's definitely a beautiful thing. I've been told they don't let me there, but it's I understand it's a good one. So, hey guys, anybody have anything they'd like to share?
Matt does.
Yeah, what would that be?
There you go.
How are you?
Good. People are starting to hurt nature, and it's not right because all the animals need homes, like pandas, because people are starting to hurt their homes.
So we should say, stop doing that, right?
Yeah, they need homes to survive or else they can't survive.
Well, as I look at you, I want to take better care of this planet for you. So thank you for sharing that with us. That was beautiful. Wow, that's definitely, I think we should send that to the president or something. That was good. So what I want to do is pray, but first, I want to share with you, you hear me every week talk about practitioners. I'm going to invite our spiritual practitioners to stand in a moment. But once a year, we have a few that come through all the training and become licensed. And to become a licensed practitioner, one takes, it's a minimum of 2 years of class studies. And then after those 2 years, they can go on to the two-year licensing program, the professional studies, and they take a first-year practitioner and a second-year practitioner. So if they were on the fast track, they could complete their studies in 4 years. But after they complete, they then have to take a licensing exam that gets sent to the home organization in Golden, Colorado, where they sit there and see if they got the right consciousness and answer the questions correctly. And if they pass that, then they have to sit before a panel of ministers and practitioners that then sit without judgment, but judging, whether they have the consciousness and answer the questions on the spot. And I want you to know that we presented four candidates to the oral panels this last week, and all four have passed. And if you're here today, I'd like to invite you to stand so we can say congratulations to Valerie Rodriguez, to Rick Mirica, your board president, who took that out. And the other two around here, Deb Sandler, she was at the first service, and then Vicky, bless her. So it's very exciting. What I would like to do now is invite them, along with all the spiritual practitioners, to stand as I pray in this moment. And I invite all of us to just feel the power and the presence of this uplifting, energetic expression of life, that presence, that divine source, that first breath, first cause, that all animating something, that which brought me into expression, that reminds me to come back into the resonant field of the divine expression as I see and I feel and I sense all that which I am, which is God expressing for what God is, I am. And it's in this great I am moment that I speak from this deductive perspective, from this intuitive perspective, where there is a knowing of the fullness, the wholeness of being without necessarily the logical, reasoning, sequential place of getting there, but there's something inside of me that knows that wholeness is the truth, and I stand in this realization and proclaim that God is, and that is what I know is the truth for each and every one of us, that the fullness and the presence of God moves in this life and that we become that activity of God, that as I look out here, what I see is God expressing as each and every one, and I know right now that if there's any human error, any dis-ease, discomfort, out of balance, out of alignment, whatever we want to call that which doesn't seem to be flowing, that is caught up in the human experience, that has pulled us into that hypnotic trance, I know right now that there is a deeper realization of wholeness that separates those tracks and allows us to move forward with a deep knowingness and conviction that all is well, because all is already well within the mind of God, the only mind that is. And so if you're experiencing anything that seems to be anchoring you back, a weight that is just too much, whether it's in your body, relationship, finances, interaction with another human being, let it go. Let it dissolve like a mirage into the nothingness from which it came. For there is no error in the mind of God, in the allness of God, in the fullness of God, in the truth of being, which is God expressing as each and every one of us. I need not figure out in this moment how to dissolve it. I just open up to a greater way of being. I no longer hold onto the branch hoping it's going to work. I know and put my trust in the wings that can fly. And no longer put my attention on the worry and the anxiety, expecting the worst, but I begin to trust with an unshakable faith in that divine wisdom that guides the universe and the galaxy is the same wisdom guiding my life and my world right now. And this is what I surrender to. I intuitively know that there is a creative urge that is seeking to express itself that pulls me to a new place of self-expression with the richness and the ease and the grace of being. I'm just so thankful to be in this place. And it's in this divine emanation of the truth that healing happens, not because I tell it, because there's just no space for any otherness. I know it's the truth for every prayer request that has been brought to our prayer request chest. For the note that was handed to me as I was walking out here today, that someone had got a detached retina, not here at Seaside, but a request that came in. I know right where they are. God sees with the wholeness and the perfection of being. For our beloved Debbie McDonald's dad, who goes in for brain surgery tomorrow, that operation is already a success in the mind of God, and the hands of the surgeons are the hands of God. And the result far exceeds expectation of wholeness. There's love here. This is a community, a spiritual family, a tribe and a clan that continues to expand its boundaries because we, as individual contributors to the consciousness of what Seaside is willing to stretch those bounds for this community. For it continues to be a place of love and caring without the judgment that invites and welcomes all to play and to share their gifts. Seaside continues to grow and to thrive and to prosper. And as we move forward through time, we find ourselves shining a light for those seekers of the truth to know that this is a home, a haven, a safe place that is alive, dynamic, and growing and prospering, and that each get to be part of that dynamic energy. And this I'm grateful to see and proclaim, to know is the truth. I stand with a sense of gratitude and appreciation, not to anyone, but just with a sense of thanksgiving in the heart for seeing the presence of God's activity as very experience of this community. And I let go to this with that faith, with trusting the faith, with a deep knowingness that the divine has its way, as always has and always will, and so I will not fight it. Thy will be mine right now, and find that it's far greater than I could ever have imagined. So I allow myself to be a creative expression of the greater yet to be that is seeking life here and now. And so it is. Amen.
There was a time in my life I thought I had to do it all for myself. I didn't know the grace of God was sufficient. I didn't know the love of God was at hand. But now I can say, if you are discouraged,
struggling just to make it through another day. You've got to let it go. And this is what you have to say. I release and I let go. I let the Spirit run my life. And my heart is open wide. Yes, I'm only here for God. So no more struggle, no more strife. With my faith I see the light. I am free in the Spirit. Yes, I'm only here for God. That I release and I let go. I let the Spirit run my life. And my heart is open wide. Yes, I'm only here for God. No more struggle, no more strife. With my faith I see the light. I am free in the Spirit. Yes, I'm only here for God. Seaside, sing it out loud. What you guys saying?
I let the Spirit run my life. And my heart is open wide. Yes, I'm only here.
Affirmation's an easy one this week, and it is, I trust in God. Together, I trust in God. Touch your heart and say it like you mean it. I trust in God. One more time. I trust in God. And our song of grace.
I'm living in love. I'm living in peace. I'm living my life for what I believe. Through joys and through fears in this world I walk. God's grace shines on me and it shines on us all. We are living in grace. We are living in grace. We are living. United we stand as one family. We honor all truth as together we walk. God's grace moves through me and it moves through us all. We are living in grace. We are living in grace. We are living. Thank you.
He's laying down.
Alrighty then. You want me to find someone?
Yeah. Well, give us some thought. Forrest is having a hand up
off the street and drag them in.